Hi everyone, today I'll be painting a landscape in soft pastels. While I walk you through my process, my thinking and the reasoning behind my choices, I will include some tips and tricks and the basic steps and elements of my creative process. The very first step of this painting process for me is the underpainting. This means that I put down the main shapes and values without caring for detail whatsoever. I just put down the initial sketch with the bulk of color, with shadows and lights here and there, just to make sure that everything is in place and to have a complete picture of the painting without caring too much about anything specific. You can see here that for this specific painting, I'm mainly using cool colors and especially blue for the areas that are going to be in shadow. I do use some purples as well on the road, and some warm colors like mainly yellow but also some oranges and reds for the areas that I know will be in the light. The reason I did that, the reason I chose blue and yellow as my main underpainting colors, is because I know that I want the final painting to be mainly green because of the trees and the grass, and with blue and yellow, creating green obviously, this is going to help me create some warm and cool greens while not creating mud in the process, and it will also help me bring out some extra variations of green without even trying. The mixture of various greens with various yellows and blues underneath will only bring out some more variety without a lot of effort on my side. Once I put down all the colors and the shapes that I need to, I blend them all together with an alcohol wash. I have already made a video on that and why I love using an alcohol wash so much, so if you're interested in that, go and watch that video. I will put the link right up in your screen right now. And I make sure that I blend where I want to blend. I just try not to contaminate the colors too much. For that reason, I start with the lighter colors. As you can see, I started with the sky and then move all around to the blues and the purples. That way I don't contaminate the colors too much. And I leave the yellows last after I have cleaned my brush very, very well. In the end, I can also use my brush to create shapes and elements where there were none, as I do with the tree trunks, and generally create a painterly style while I move the pigment around the way I want it to be in the end. Once the alcohol wash is dry, I am ready to start painting. I will use my underpainting as a guide and I will let it peek through so that it creates some extra variation, as I said earlier. At this stage, I find that it is easier if you go with the softer pastels on the range of the soft pastels. You can see here that I am forced to use some harder pastels though, because at the time I was painting this painting, I didn't have all the colors I needed in extra soft pastels. It requires some extra effort for me to blend them together and create the colors that I want, but I do what I have to do with what I have at the time. I have mentioned in the past that while I think that having good quality art supplies will help you have better results and will make your life easier, I am a strong believer that you have to work with what you have at any given time in order to practice and improve. Not having art supplies, or the ones that you want anyway, shouldn't stop you from creating anyway, and upgrading to better quality art supplies in the future will obviously help you a lot, but it is not a necessary requirement in order to create art. Practicing with what you have will make you come up with new ideas in order to make it work and will pay off in the long run. It will also make you appreciate the good quality art supplies better once you can actually have them. Anyway though, back to my painting process. From this stage and on, it becomes a little bit more intuitive. I look at my reference photo, obviously, but I go around the painting, adding darks and lights. I'm focusing on the whole painting at the same time so that I can judge my values best and that I can see where the painting needs more work and where I'm satisfied with it. If I work on a specific area for too long, I lose the whole image of the painting, and I find that it is harder to balance everything out in the end. It's also very helpful to just stand up and look at your painting from far away, because that way it's easier to ignore the details and see the whole picture at the same time, to see where the painting lacks or if you need to improve something and change something in the process. Another thing I tend to use to my benefit is to go back and forth with adding elements and taking them away. What I mean by that is, as you can see that I did with the tree branches, and as I do later with the sky holes, I like to add the elements in and then go over them with the foliage, with the leaves of the tree, so that I can create some randomness. It's harder to put the branches and the sky holes exactly where they are and exactly the shape they need to be. So if you go back and forth with creating them and then covering them up with the leaves and then just putting some together again and again adding leaves, it creates some depth and some randomness where there wouldn't be none if it was just up to me to put everything in the correct place from the beginning. As I don't exactly copy my reference from up close with every single detail, it is up to this process to create some depth and randomness that wouldn't be there otherwise. And I wanted to elaborate a little bit on that, because in the past I had a tendency to add a lot of detail, as you may already know, and I am slowly straying away from that. I don't think that you need to add every single detail in order to create the illusion of what you want to create. Having the correct values and maybe colors will create the atmosphere and the elements you need in your painting without having to spell out every single thing in your painting. If you create the correct illusion, the eye of the viewer will fill in the rest. It's something that we do as people naturally, so if someone looks at your painting and everything is where it should be, you don't need the detail in order to explain exactly what you have painted. You can see here that I haven't painted any single leaf, but it's not hard to say that these are trees because the elements are there. So it's up to you to decide how much detail you want to add and if this would be something that you'd be interested in trying. Also, you don't have to copy your reference exactly. As I said earlier, I'm using my reference now as a guidance, but I don't copy everything exactly. I have done that in the past too, and it's not something that I like doing anymore. I think that having the creative liberty to add and remove elements as you see fit is something that is very, very interesting, and it creates some extra interest in your painting as well. Obviously, that's something that you have to decide for yourself, if you like it or not, if you want to try it or not, but right now for me it's very exciting to see what I can do with a reference photo without copying it exactly, so that I can create something of my own, something that didn't necessarily exist, that it's out of my mind sometimes, and I tend to explore that even more in the future. So yeah, I think that was all I wanted to mention for this specific painting and the process I followed in order to create it. I hope it was a little bit helpful and I hope you enjoyed watching this video. If you did, please leave a thumbs up before you go and maybe share it with your friends, with your artistic friends, if you think that it would help them as well. Consider subscribing to my channel for more videos like this in the future and hit the bell button if you'd like to get notified whenever I upload a new video. I hope to see you in the next one. Until then, be safe, be happy, and keep going for your dreams. Bye!